este evento. El objetivo fundamental es que saquen todo el provecho de ponentes como Arup. Arup es un experto, es uno de los gurús que tenemos para el tema de base de datos. Él, bueno, pues tiene mucha expertise en la parte de seguridad, en la parte de tuning, conoce el tema de rack. O sea, realmente es una persona que está muy especializada en todo lo que corresponde al tema de base de datos. El objetivo de esto es que ustedes entiendan y que conozcan las nuevas tecnologías, que tengan de primera mano el contenido de expertos como Arup y que puedan llevarse una experiencia agradable. Este webinar que estamos haciendo va a ser complementario a un evento que tenemos ahora en puerta, que se llama Expert Summit, del cual también Arup les va a comentar un poco. De entrada, el webinar se va a repartir en inglés, debido a que Arup, bueno, pues es de otro país. Si alguien tiene alguna duda o alguna pregunta, por favor, con Luis, con Arup o conmigo, pueden resolverla. ¿Sale? Bueno, pues de mi lado creo que sería todo. Arup, if you want to start right now, I think that I give all the instructions and a brief presentation about what this is going to be about.
Okay, great. Thank you. Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me okay, Ricardo? Luis?
Yes, we can hear you. I was mute my microphone, but you can start right now.
Yep, I can hear you.
Okay, good.
We can
Okay, all
hear
right.
you.
All right, thank you very much. Hola, and welcome to happen on May 3rd and 4th and 5th, and I hope you want to join us. In this session today, I'm going to explain to you what you can expect to get in that the 3-day conferences. I'm sure you have questions, so what you can expect to learn in those 3 days, that's what I'm going to talk about. So without further ado, let's jump into this one. The agenda of the 3 days will be, today will be, why you should attend this seminar. If whatever your job role is, how can you get help from the seminar? That's something I will explain, number one. Number two, what you expect in this seminar. And this is going to be a 3-day seminar. Let me explain to you what the 3 days will have one by one. The schedule will be, first day, we'll talk about performance tuning in Oracle. This is the Oracle Database Performance Tuning. Not necessarily specific to RAC, is for everything, any Oracle database, the first day. The second day, we talk about Oracle database security from beginner to advanced. So if you have never done any Oracle database security work, I guarantee you that by the end of this day, you will become an expert in database security. And finally, on day three, we will have a free format IT discussion, where we talk about anything without any presentation material, anything you have any question for. So let me go one by one. The first one is the Oracle Database Performance Tuning. Let's see what we can expect from this. Why this session? Why you have to attend it? It's probably the first question you have. Can you answer this question? What is the most important task of DBAs? Some people answer the question, well, creating tables, resetting passwords. Yes, absolutely. That's something you probably have to do. But that job makes it a very simple and a commodity job. That means anybody can do it without any proper skill. And as a result of that's not exactly a career you want. I said, not just a commodity job. If you answer this question, some people do, taking backups and making sure the recovery is possible. Absolutely. As a DBA, you have to make sure that the database is possible to be backed up and the database can be recovered in case of a failure. That is obviously given. But backups are generally are scripted. You write a script once and the backup simply go every day. You don't intervene. You don't do a backup every day. They're done by the script. Recovery, on the other hand, is same thing. You don't do recovery every day. In fact, you probably never do a recovery until something actually breaks. So, and some companies do these recovery exercises once a year or twice a year on a different location, but generally also that is also scripted or well documented, etc. So if you think about it, what is that the most important thing or most of the time the DBAs do? It's not creating tables, resetting password, taking backups, and making sure recovery is possible. the most important task and the most time-consuming task by the typical DBA is performance tuning. Every time you go to your office, you go sit down at your desk, someone or other complains about performance. Database is slow. It's not going as fast. What is the problem? If you go back and you check your own activity, you see you probably spend 90% of your work, of your day, on tuning for performance, improving performance, making sure things don't slow down and those kind of things. And this is exactly where most DBAs are identified as senior, junior, medium level, etc. This performance tuning typically how you demonstrate your expertise as the DBA. And of course, if you know how to do the performance tuning, you get much better jobs. Well, this all sounds great then. Then how come most DBAs are not really that good in performance tuning? Well, here is the reason why. There's a problem. The problem is that performance tuning is not really simple. It is pretty stressful if you think about it, because it's not a straightforward job. You don't know what exactly you have to do. You have to do, you find out something, based on that you do something else. That doesn't work out, you do something else, and so on and so forth. That's why it's very stressful. There is no identifiable process or a strict process that goes in. So next thing is that whoever your customer is, your end users, they demand it immediately. They say, is it done yet? Is it done yet? They probably tell you the problem, and the next minute they ask you, is it fixed? Of course it's not fixed. It takes time to fix it. But people demand it. That makes it even more stressful. The third one is a whole lot. You still have to know about it. Just knowing the syntax, knowing the command, that's not going to help you in performance tuning. And the problem is that there is no end to how much you know. You have to keep on knowing everything to be really effective. And finally, the lack of people. Because of all these things, you don't find too many people are pretty good in performance tuning. Which means, if you are one of those people who are pretty good in performance tuning, then you have a much better career. You get a better job, better paycheck, better salary. So that's why it's actually very attractive to be in performance tuning. So let's see what we can do about it. So this is something, I have a very generic chart. If you define a graph like this, complexity of the task in performance tuning, I'm not talking about everything, complexity, from simple on the left to complex on the right, and the number of DBAs who are in that particular area, you would find about 90% of the DBAs are involved in this simple task, creating tables, resetting passwords, adding space, and all those kind of things, or adding columns, etc., all those things. 90% of the tasks, very, very simple. The complex tasks, like performance tuning, etc., only about 10%. But when it all comes to getting a paycheck or earning potential, this could be a little on the simple side, but those 10% who know how to do it well, they command a much, much better salary. So, that being said, we want to make sure we want to be in this right, that's 10%, not in the left 90%. So, how can you do that? Do you have to study a lot? Do you have to work very hard? Not really. You can be actually expert pretty soon. You can be in this 10%. Make some effort, of course, but not a significant effort. So what's the secret? Here's the secret. If you define the number of things that cause problems in performance, let's call that occurrence. On the left, you have low occurrence, and on the right, you have high occurrence. That means number of things that could go wrong in performance. A lot of things are on the left side, and not so many things. And on the x-axis, you have how difficult it is to implement the solution. Let's say easy to difficult. You see, about 50% of the problems are actually in the right top corner. That's called easy to implement, but happens all the time. For example, say locking contention is a big problem. Happens all the time. How is it to fix it? You'll be surprised, it's extremely easy to fix it. And this is another example, DB file sequential read. That's a lot of problem. It happens all the time. In fact, I would say about 80% of the performance problems are because of DB file sequential read or scattered read. They happen all the time. It is actually very easy to fix it. So those 50% of the time, they're in the right, the top right corner. Then about 20%, I would say, easy to fix, but don't happen too much. Then about 10%, don't happen too much. Also, it kind of difficult to fix. And finally, the last 10%, difficult to fix, and also don't happen, and happens a lot as well. If we do this thing, if you take the first, this 20% here, and this 10% here, and the 50% here, you add them up, it becomes 80%. You see, these things are easy to fix, or if it is not easy to fix, at least they happen so often that it is worth fixing it. Because if you go to the 10% over here, if you fix the 10%, guess what? Then you fix the high number of times it actually happens. So this 80%, and this is a secret. If you don't go over everything, if you just go over the 80% of the performance problems, it's very easy to fix that and to become an expert in that. And that's the secret. So here's the deal. Here's the first thing is to do. So if you say define some kind of a graph that how much you have to learn knowledge on your x-axis and how effective you are on the y-axis. When I say effective, that means you fix a problem. Just because you know something doesn't mean that you'll fix it. You may not be able to fix it. So knowledge and effectiveness. If you look at that, it's actually see the graph kind of looks like this. After some time, just because you know a lot doesn't mean that you're effective. In fact, in my opinion, you actually become less effective because you know too much. You don't understand exactly which one you have to do, use all the time, and therefore your effectiveness kind of comes down. So you have to stop right there when your graph comes down to. And that's our secret. You have to know enough to fix 80% of the problem. If you can do that, you become an expert. That's about it. The trick is, in this area, you have to be very strong. You have to be. You can't lax in this. If you are very strong in this, you are a master of 8% of the problem. The rest 20%, let somebody else solve it. But once you define that 80% of the problem, that's it. So that being said, how difficult is that to be a master in that area I just mentioned over here? So that's where my course comes in. In my course, I make sure that you become a master in this specific area. So what is the methodology? As a methodology, I do not talk about mathematics, no Ewing theory, no probabilistic algorithms. You might have seen that some of the instructors use that, Ewing theory, probability, and all that thing. I will not. You could be very strong in mathematics, fine. But you don't have to use that to be an expert in Oracle database performance tuning. That's the first thing. All the instructions on how to use this thing will be the language we all understand, SQL. Whether it's English or Spanish, doesn't matter. At the end, you understand SQL, and that's what we have. Every script, everything I'm going to use, you can download them and use right away. There is no proprietary information in that. Number two, no special tools. My methods is that I don't want to use any kind of paid tool. I want to use whatever comes with Oracle using plain SQL. You want to buy a third-party software, anything that costs money. If you buy a third-party software, it should be free. That's the thing, my foundation. Oracle does have things like AWR, ADBM, etc. Those are extra cost options. I know that. I will also explain to you, if you do not have access to AWR, what you can do. And I just simple SQL statements as well. So those kind of things, I'm going to explain that. My point is that you do not have to buy anything additional to use all those tools. And finally, as I mentioned, not too much information. You just have to know enough to get 99% of the work done. The rest 1% don't happen a lot. If they happen, well, you're not going to be good at that. But you have to be good in fixing those 99% of the work. And that's what the methodology of this course is. So if that is the case, you might ask the question, why do most DBAs actually fail? It should be so simple. Well, my experience is that I've been 22 years in this industry. My experience shows that most DBAs have no idea where to start. So for example, say, I've seen this example. There's a performance problem. Someone says, let's bring up VMstat. Well, that doesn't tell you anything right off the bat. You have to know why you are bringing up VMstat. Also, they have no solid conceptual foundation. I challenge you, if you see somebody who is pretty good in performance tuning, go and ask the person, explain to me what a latch is. That's very difficult. Most people don't have an understanding of what a latch is. Instead, they try to fix a latch contention issue. If you don't understand what a latch is, how can you fix it? There is no way to fix it. So a solid conceptual foundation is the key, but most people don't have it. And second, third one is that they have too many tools. If you think about a typical DBA, they have Toad, they have SQL Developer, they have Spotlight, you name it, SQL, what is that, the thing called variety of tools. But they have no idea what tool to use where. Similarly, auto-provided tools like AWR, SQL Tuning Advisor, ADDM, all of that. So you have grid control. Yeah, they have tools, but they have no idea where to use what tool. In fact, the more tools you have, the more confused you are because you have. That's why the fourth one is important. You have to control how many tools you have. The important thing is that have a few tools, but know them well. Think about if you're a hobbyist. Let's say your hobby is carpentry. I don't know how many people have carpentry as a hobby. You can go and buy every possible tool a tool shop can probably sell you. In the US, we have something called Sears, you might have heard about that, or Home Depot, or Lowe's, you might have heard about that as well. Those are called the shops. They will sell you any kind of tool you need to do your carpentry. But if you have a lot of carpentry tools, does that make you a great carpenter? I don't think so. It depends on using the tools effectively. And my experience was that most DBAs have no idea how to use the tool effectively. It's important to understand how to use the tool instead of having a lot of tools. So that's the thing, I think. So this course, what does it do? First of all, I'll fix these problems one by one. I need to make sure that you have to have a solid understanding of how Oracle works internally. Not too much, just enough so that you understand the mechanics or the internal working of Oracle. That's important. Once you have a solid understanding, it becomes easier to find out why certain problem happens. Second, the stress is, my important point is that you have to be effective, not just know everything. That doesn't help you. You have to be effective. If someone tells you, can you fix the problem? Your answer should be yes. Not that you know how latch contention really works. That doesn't help you. You got to know how to fix it at the end of the day. You can measure something to the millisecond or a microsecond, but if you don't know how to fix it, what good is it? You have to, the stress is the word effective and not just knowing everything. And finally, I will supply all the tools, which means nothing but scripts, SQL statements, OS scripts, whatever. You will get everything, you can download that. You don't have to type them at all, and you can get that and start using them from day one. So what is the objective? Go back to our original graph. About 90% of the problems and the people are engaged in the low complexity task and they earn less money. About 10% do the complex work and they earn much, much more money. Our objective is to make sure you move from this 90% to this 10%. That's our objective. And at the end of the course, you will be actually able to do that 10%. Idea is that you have to be effective, not know everything, but know enough to make you back in that 10%. That's the whole concept behind it. So that being said, you have to ask the question, who I am? What is, how can I make these claims without knowing anything? Well, I am a DBA for the last 22 years. That's all I have been, an Oracle DBA. Actually, I've been 23 years. I got my first Oracle DBA production support job in 1993 in Oracle 6, and I'm saying I'm still going. I haven't become anything different. So you tell me I've been using DataGuard, RAC, Exadata, security, you name it, or whatever you have, Oracle has, I have done it because that's the only thing I have done in the last 22 years. I'm not becoming a developer, I'm not becoming a sysadmin, I'm not becoming a manager, I just become that. So that's why if you talk about the problem, I must have experienced it from that. And things have improved, of course, over a period of time, but as things have improved, I also perfected my skills. So every performance issue can think of, I have experienced that and effectively solved that. So an expert is not somebody who knows everything. An expert is somebody who has gone through the problems and fixed it. So that's what makes an expert. And knowing everything is probably not going to work very well. Finally, because I am not a full-time instructor, I'm a full-time DBA. Most likely, most of you are full-time DBAs. You have your job. I understand how you must be feeling. That's why I give you some real-life advice. I will not bore you with mathematics, Qing theory, etc. It will be simple, plain SQL script, cell script, etc. And most important, that I will show a demo of every relevant concept. Because without that, it's kind of difficult to understand what I'm talking about. So that's the general thing about what the first day course will be, performance tuning in Oracle. Again, objective is to make sure that you move from this 90% to this 10% to have a substantial jump in your career. Okay, so that's the first day. Let's go to the second day. Second day, talk about Oracle security from beginner to advanced. So what do you say? Okay, so the first thing, why security? Well, in the past, the databases were islands. That means you are not connected to any other system. If I don't know how many of you actually go back in the past to the time I'm talking about, those days, most systems are batch process oriented. Or even if they were OLTP systems, they were probably isolated. They were not connected to anything. The systems or the terminals or the client servers, they were connected to the database server directly. That's about it. There was no concept of internet. If the client server was there, the client was connected to the server specifically. There's nobody in between, not like a three-tier architecture typically. And as a result of that, only a few people access those systems. So as a database as well. It wasn't connected to the internet. Actually, there was no internet to begin with. But even if the internet was there, it wasn't connected to the internet. And as a result of that, it wasn't exposed to many hackers because there are only few people. You have to be in the permitted schedule to actually connect to the database in the first place to do any kind of attack. That was the case earlier. Not anymore, as you know. Now, pretty much every system is connected to every other system. You have to open up the activity because things have become very different. Oracle databases has become way more than batch processes. There are all kinds of things going on in the Oracle databases. There are all kinds of ports are open. And probably the most difficult thing has been so far that there are people have become hackers. They just love to break something. And just either whether it is just pride or ego or whatever, they want to break something. And that's what that culture has evolved. And as a result of that, every system, including database systems, have become a problem. So that's why more demands on security. But that's not just for these hackers or the islands. The demands on security has come for something else, like government mandates. All these things I'm talking about here that apply to probably to US, like Surveillance Oxley, SOX is generally called, Gravelich-Bliley Act, HIPAA, etc., or European Union mandate, privacy, security, etc. So I'm pretty sure there must be something very similar to that in Latin American countries as well, because every country demands the security on every system, not database system. These are not just nice to have. These are requirements. You got to do it. If you do not do it, then you are illegal. That's a big problem here. So that's no longer you have to say, yeah, it's good to have security. You must have security. Because if you don't, your company may be shut down. Or like European Union, if you do not comply to their standards, then you cannot do business with European Union customers. That means effectively, if you're a US-based company, for example, doesn't matter. You cannot communicate, you cannot do business with European Union customers. So effectively, your business shuts down. So it's important that security, so if the government requires security. And second is that industry regulations. Like for example, the payment card industry, PCI. PCI says that if you are not PCI compliant, you cannot accept credit cards. Well, most businesses, if you don't accept credit cards, you might as well close down. So it's not nice to have. You must have it to just to sustain your business. Similarly, you know, Visa card holder security, there are other things as well. These are not government regulations. They are industry regulations. But you have to comply with them. That's the reason why security has become the most important for business, not just nice to have anymore. So what's the problem? The problem is that most people think typically an afterthought. They don't think about security from the beginning. They think about security after everything is complete and the system is about to be launched. And as a part of that, very little attention is paid during design. But if you don't take care of the design, it becomes very difficult to do it afterwards, and sometimes impossible to do it afterwards. And then everything kind of breaks down. That's why security becomes important in the design itself, number one. Number two, specialized skill set. How many DBAs do you know who can say, okay, we're pretty good in security? Very few. In fact, if you compare it to performance tuning, it's way smaller than that. Because it's actually nobody thought about security quite a while ago. It has happened very important in the most recent times. So as a result of that, very small subset of DBAs actually know about it. And those people who know about it are not even DBAs anymore. They become specialized security consultants, etc. But DBAs get blamed when something breaks, won't they? If you are a DBA of a system, somebody hacked the system, guess what? Who gets blamed? Not the security person. You probably get blamed. So you have to know about it. If you are going to be blamed for that, you have to know about it. Consulting companies, because they're not in their floors. So whenever a security project comes up, typically a company goes outside and hires a consulting company. And the consulting company make a ton of money just by going through security consulting. Well, why is that a problem then? It becomes overwhelming. There's so much to do and a lot of things to consider. The thing is, where do I start? That's a big question everybody has to ask. So that's why, in my experience, these are the three big high-level problem areas where that's why the problem is the people are not engaged in security as much as they're supposed to. So how do you fix it? Actually, it's very simple to fix it. Once again, I go back to here's the secret, how to fix that. Once again, I go back to the same diagram I mentioned earlier, impact. What about the low impact? I mean, what can I do that has a huge impact on security? Let's say things I do that creates a more secure environment, and on the left side, not so much more secure. So the impact is low and high impact. On the x-axis, I also say, how difficult is it to implement? Easy or difficult? And just like I showed you in the performance tuning. And just like I showed you before, it has an identical graph. About 50% of the problems are actually high impact. Okay? They are very easy to fix. But once you fix them, they are very impactful. That means they increase the security tremendously. That's the 50% problem. About 20% are also easy to fix, but don't have so much of impact. That's what got to be fixed. That's a little bit. And finally, 10% of the thing are difficult and do not have that much of impact. 10% are high impact and difficult. For example, if you are talking about, let's say, Oracle WebLogic server to fixing something in that, that may be low impact, because if you do not use Oracle WebLogic, that doesn't really matter. So that might actually fall under that 10% security thing. Or let's say another one, ETL, say external proxies, AEXT proc. If you are using it, fine. If you're not using it, then that also comes into the low impact one. So some kind of things like that. Also, connection manager, there are different Oracle streams, all kinds of things. They might come under that low impact things and kind of difficult to maintain that as well. But the trick is, this is a kind of broad division of problems and how impactful they are and how easy or difficult they have to implement. And just like that, if you take this 50% over here, the 20% over here, and the 10% over here, if you look at this, these are easy to fix, but could have high impact or low impact. But even if it's difficult to fix, they have high impact. Altogether, it comes out to 80%. So like 80-20-20 rule, anything we can fix that they can come down, we can actually fix that. It's about 80% of the problem easily. And that how you can fix that, you can get that in one day. So how can you do this? So here's the thing. If I take this thing, effort needed, you can probably fix about half the problems in just 1 week. It can be kind of difficult to believe it, isn't it? It just takes 1 week to fix 50% of the problems, security problems, in Oracle data. About 30% you can do that in about a month, and about 10% in about a quarter. Of course, things could be different based on your organization, how difficult it is to push through changes and all that thing, but these are like a general things I can talk about, you can fix that. So that takes care of about 90% of the problem of the security challenges in Oracle database. That's it, that's the thing. So how do you fix it? But understanding all these things takes about 6 months. That's why even if you can do all these things in about 3 months time frame, it takes about 6 months to fix for you, but not for you. Why not? Because you will learn all this in just 1 day. That's the interesting part of it. So how can I do that? Well, here's an example. You might have heard about it. Oracle security patches. They come out every quarter. Actually, now they're coming out with the PSU patches, which makes it even worse. It fixes some security holes. But the problem is that it doesn't tell you what those security holes are. So you won't be able to tell if those security holes are even applicable to you or not. And they're combined with PSU. When that happens, as you know, PSU also contains the bug fixes, the patches, not necessarily connected to security, just the general bug fixes. The moment you apply the PSU, it may introduce additional bugs because they could change the functionality. Even if they're not bugs, because the functionality is changed, your application may behave differently after they apply the PSU. So, here's the dilemma. If you don't apply, you could be hacked because you have a security hole. But if you apply, your application may break. It won't necessarily break and guaranteed. It may break. So what do you do? Sometimes it's just not possible to avoid it. Sometimes your security requirement, for example, PCI compliance. PCI compliance says that you have to apply them. But if you apply them, well, it's going to break something. So what do you do? Or if it does break something, you get blamed. If you apply them and something, your application breaks, you also get blamed. What do you do? That's a big question, isn't it? So this is exactly we will discuss how we can address this kind of problems so that you do not have to get blamed, yet you fix the security problems. So you will learn how to proactively close some risks. The word is proactively. If you take this proactive action, and the moment you have taken the actions, those security vulnerabilities will be gone. So whatever the Oracle security patches fix, if you don't know what exactly the fix, you don't have to know. If you take care of that completely, boom, it's over with. So that's something we'll see how to do this. How do you do this? So this is how it says skill set. If you take a pie chart of every DBA, all the DBAs, you see about 95% of the DBAs are okay with anything except security. Only about 5% are engaged or at least know about the concept of security. Only 5%. In fact, I could be actually generous. It could be even less than that if you think about that. And by the way, resetting password is not security concept. Something you have to know, something internal to security concept. So that's a problem. But the problem, or another problem is also, people who are this 95%, they earn something. People who are this 5%, they earn a whole lot because they know certain things. You just don't know. So our objective, just like the first time, is to move you from this 95% to this 5%. If the course is going to help you to move that. As a result of that, you get a boost in career, substantially better job, satisfaction, and all that. Good to go from there. So that's the objective of this course, just like the first one. And if you combine the performance tuning skill set and the security skill set together, you might find about 1% of the total DBAs may have that skill set. But by going through this 2-day course, and at the end you have a 3-day course, you will have covered, you have jumped from the 99% of the DBAs to the 1% of the DBAs. That will substantially increase your career potential. I'm sure you have a lot of questions. So before you ask questions, let me go through the questions I saw. First of all, do I need to learn about advanced computer security first before attending this? Absolutely not. You will learn everything you have to know in this course. You don't have to know about computer security. That's the big problem most people have. For example, I was going through one of the security seminars earlier on Oracle security, and they talked about the rootkit. Well, I have to first know about rootkit to understand what the problem is. And that's the big problem. Then because I have to know something more to come to the session. But the beauty of my session is that I don't expect that you know about those problems. If you have to know, I would explain to you at that time. So you learn everything in this one day. You don't have to know anything before that. Number two is another question. Do you have to be a hacker to actually break something to know about to be an expert? No, not at all. You don't have to be a hacker at all. If you just have to know how things can be broken. You don't have to be a thief to become a policeman. You just have to know how the thieves get in and fix some problems. And I think those problems, and you're okay with that. Will I have to know about, then, since I'm going to just have one day to know about security, does it mean that you have to know about short-term security and not long-term security? Not at all. You will learn about both long-term and short-term securities in this one-day course, not just short-term. So again, if you divide the work, something you can do in just in a week, something you can do in a month, and something you can do in a quarter. So those all those things you learn in this one-day course. So that covers about security. Finally, we come to day three, where we talk about free format IT discussions. This is a little bit different from that for both two. First of all, there will not be any presentations or a material. It will be a completely free-format discussion where you ask questions, I answer. I will probably use a chalkboard or a whiteboard to present it, or my touch screen. I can probably draw on that thing as well. We'll see that. There will be no prepared slide. It can be as much technical or as less technical as you want. It's not something I will be driving. Something you will be driving at as well. This is something you can ask. It again doesn't have to be security or performance training. It could be anything else. For example, here are some suggested topics. Again, suggested only. They don't have to be limited to this one. You might have a question about big data. And question might be, what is big data? What is the evolution of big data? What are the other non-relational technologies and how do they interact with Oracle? Something like that. So the thing you can have a question like that. Well, that's something we will cover that as well. Another could be cloud computing. You have heard the word a lot. You might be a little afraid to ask what is cloud computing, how is it different from, and the big question is that how do you use cloud computing concepts with Oracle databases, etc. You might have heard another word called database sharding. That's a very buzzword nowadays, sharding for high availability. Well, what is sharding? How do you do sharding in Oracle databases? All that thing you'll do as well. Internet of Things, IoT, must have heard about it a lot. What is that? How do they interact with Oracle databases, etc.? DevOps, well, I'm pretty sure you heard of it. It used to be called Agile Technologies, DevOps, different names called that. How do they actually work with Oracle databases? What are the challenges you're going to say? For about last 3 years, I've been working with the DevOps technology on all with Oracle technology. So I'll be able to cover that if you want to cover that. Cost control in Oracle projects. How do you do consolidation? Snapshot storage, you might have heard that. Backup, etc. How do you cost control? That's a question I'm pretty sure every manager, architect, leader has to have. High availability, disaster recovery, reliability, very important thing. How do you enable all that? By the way, it's not just one button you press and it becomes highly available. There are many levers or buttons you can to make something highly available. How do you make sure those things are completely highly available? So So you might ask the question, well, this is great, but why do you have to, why should you attend it if you are a BBA or a hardcore technical person? Should you attend it? Absolutely. You might have heard a lot of these new terms and technologies and concepts are introduced, like DevOps. It wasn't that term about a year ago, but now everybody is using DevOps. Agile technologies have been used for a long time. Cloud. It's a little fluffiness around the cloud. What is cloud? What is, so are you using the cloud? So do you use the cloud? If you have to use the cloud, what are the challenges you have to know as an Oracle technologist, etc.? Those kind of things you have to know, etc. Agile methodology, etc. If you don't know what these things are and you are in a part of a conversation or a discussion or a meeting, then people might think you are not in the loop of things. And so you have to know. But the problem is that, what is the time? Most of us are busy with our day jobs, which is BBA job. It's extremely, extremely exhausting. There is no time to know anything else. So that's why we don't tend to know about it. Or if we do, there are books and articles about everything. Unfortunately, there are so much that it's very difficult to cover them in detail. So this is a good opportunity for all of us to become acquainted with this new technology or new concept, and that is something you can do. Once again, you can be as technical or as less technical about this, and what topics you want to cover, what topics you don't have to cover. You can all do all these things in just one day. You can get all those things. So that brings us to third question. So again, I hope to see you at the Expert Summit. May 3rd, 3rd and 5th, Centro Banamex, Centro de Convención, Especición, Mexico City, and hopefully we'll see you there. May 3rd and 5th, again, I just set a schedule. First day is performance tuning, second day is security, and third one is the pre-format IT. That's about it. And I hope I answered your questions. I hope I answered the question of what those things, what do you expect to see in the 3 days, and why you should attend. I see that we have about 10 minutes left. At this point, I will open up for any questions you may have. Any questions? Ricardo?
Hi, everyone. Arup, perhaps... perhaps they can ask their questions or write them in the chat area, and I'm gonna translate it to you, and also the answer I will translate it from English to Spanish. Los que quieran preguntar algo de pronto a Arup, si quieren hacerlo en español y yo lo traduzco, o si quieren apuntarlo en el área de chat para que él lo vaya diciendo y yo voy resolviendo o les voy traduciendo la respuesta de Arup. ¿Sale?
Okay, I see one question from...
Okay, this is one question.
Sorry. Okay. The question from Jorge Gonzalez is that PLSQL, so you think... as you have been working with PLSQL, is there any change in the legacy code using plus instead of outer join format? So the question is that, should we be using the plus, the plus sign in outer join instead of the word outer join? Is there an advantage of that? Answer is yes, there is an advantage. You don't have to change it. But if you use a plus sign, you know that you can only do outer join on one table, not at both the tables. In Oracle 11g onwards, it gives you the ability to do outer join on both the tables. Take, for example, the employee department is a good example. Employee department, you might see an employee who is not part of any department yet. So the department number may be null. On the department table, you may have one department when there is no employee. in the past, if you wanted to find out all the departments and all the employees, you had to do two queries. One from outer join on department, other one is outer join on employee, and then union, both of them. In the Oracle 11g syntax, with the full outer join, you can simply combine that and easily do it on both sides. So that's a huge advantage of using the outer join syntax as opposed to the clause syntax. Okay, that's the first question.
There is another question in Spanish. It says, how much impact does having a great security performance can affect the availability of the database?
Great question. Yes, so security.
Jesus Javier Cabañas.
It's a great question. Security does affect availability because sometimes availability of, say, backup is a good example. Backup is required for availability. But if you don't secure your backup, that becomes vulnerable for theft. In the last 15 years, most of the data theft has happened in the United States is because of the stolen backups. So you can see, but if you don't take the backup, you don't have availability. So these two come together. You will know about this in the seminar.
Okay, so let me translate your answer to our audience. Básicamente lo que dice es que el tema de la disponibilidad es bastante importante y uno de los temas que él ha encontrado hoy en día en Estados Unidos es que cuando los backups de las bases de datos, o sea, el tener un backup de base de datos es hoy requerido para tener disponibilidad de datos. O sea, si no tienes un backup y se cae la base de datos, pues, ¿a partir de qué vas a recuperar? El tema aquí es que, ¿qué pasa cuando tú le pones, aparte del tema de seguridad, a ese backup cuando lo encriptas o lo proteges? No solo haces que la información, en caso de que se la roben, ya no sea accesible para los que se la roban, sino que ahora, del lado de tu base de datos, pues sí tienes que considerar un poco más de performance. Esa es la respuesta que nos da Rub.
Ok.
I think that there's another question. Let me... Yep. I can hear you right now.
Ok. No, any other question?
And now I can hear you. Yeah, okay. Let me translate it. Just wait a second.
Right.
Wait a second. So, we have another question for Leander. It says that if it doesn't matter if the students are just beginners in the DBA thing or beginning with database thing, so if they can attend to this kind of events, is there any issue or any problem? What are your suggestions here?
Oh, great question. No, you do not have to be an expert in the database. You can be a beginner DBA and you will get a lot out of it.
Okay, lo que Arup dice es que no se necesita ser un experto en base de datos, que en este caso pueden atender al evento y de todas maneras sacarían muchísimo provecho por los scripts y contenido que se comparte.
There's another question I see here on ADF security. Is there a question on that? Is there a question on
he can see put something up there? El que preguntó de ADF pudiera repetir la pregunta, Juan Manuel Garza Martínez, por favor. Okay, just with me repeating that they're writing the question again.
Okay. So the question is, am I going to cover ADF security? The answer is no, because that's a very client sort of security. We're talking about Oracle database security. ADF is not Oracle database, so it's not.
Ok, lo que él dice es que no vamos a tocar temas de ADF ni de desarrollo. Ahí sí, los temas de seguridad de ADF quedarían aparte.
If you see another question here, am I going to cover other databases like PostgreSQL? No, this is an Oracle database technology. Let me just text.
Okay, preguntaron si solamente si van a tocar otras tecnologías de base de datos como Postgres o como MySQL. Arup contesta que no, que solamente debe estar enfocado el tema de la base de datos de Oracle. It says, we have another question here. It says, which are your recommendations or your best practices to bring up security to a backup with Arman?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I will cover that in detail in the seminar, yes.
Do you have any recommendations right now for best security backup? Bueno, algunos comentan que en el seminario sí se van a tocar temas de cuáles son las best practices para blindar un backup con RMAN. We have another question here, Arup. It says, which tools are the best suitable to understand the AWR and ADDM?
A good question. You just don't need any tool except SQL Plus. That's it. So I will actually cover that in detail on the seminar.
Ok, Arup contesta, bueno, nos preguntaron qué herramientas son las más recomendables para interpretación de los reportes de AWR y el ADBM. Él nos comenta que con SQL Plus es más que suficiente para poder entender qué está pasando con la base de datos. Arup, it says some book you can recommend for an introduction to Oracle Security.
No, unfortunately, I don't know a single book that covers everything and in detail as well. That's the reason why I developed this seminar. So you can be, again, you have to know, you have the idea to be effective, not just know everything. I haven't seen a single book that can cover that much and be effective.
Okay. Preguntaron que cuál libro recomendaban para los temas de introducción en seguridad de base de datos. Arup contesta que no, él no conoce ningún libro tal cual que cubra todos los aspectos fundamentales de los temas de seguridad de base de datos. Lo que él recomienda es que, bueno, atiendan a los seminarios, a los eventos que constantemente estamos haciendo de la hora para poder entender todos y cada uno de los elementos de seguridad. Alejandro, ¿cómo entender al evento si vivimos afuera? Por ahí, lo que pudiéramos hacer en este caso, si quieres, decimos cómo lo pudieran hacer aquellos que están lejos y que no puedan venir al DF. Pero bueno, si quieres, pasamos a la siguiente pregunta, que es un poquito más técnica y que podemos aprovechar el tiempo de Arup. Ahorita respondemos bien tu pregunta, Alejandro. So Arup, we have another question here. It says that if this event is going to cover just security in a basic level, or if you're going to touch some topics about advanced security. The using of audit vault, the database vault, data masking, and encryption.
I will. I know it's not basic, sorry, it's advanced. Yeah, we will cover that. Audit vault, database vault.
Sí se van a tocar todos esos temas, enmascaramiento de datos, encriptación, uso de los diferentes vaults de la base de datos en el evento. Arup, another question. It says, what security tools did you recommend to audit a database? Security tools like Tsukuba or Imperva?
So first of all, understand what those tools are for, like Imperva, etc. Guardium is another tool. They are called out-of-the-database tools. So they are pretty good to make sure that DBA doesn't tamper with the audit table, auditor. So those are good. Yes, I'm going to just touch on that, but that's not going to be the course itself, because remember, the course says that you don't have to buy anything except what comes with Oracle free. So I'm going to just talk about that a little, but not going to go in detail because those are not Oracle products.
Ok, lo que bueno, nos preguntaron qué herramientas recomiendan para auditar una base de datos como Tsukuba o Imperva. Lo que Arup comenta es que en el seminario o lo que él ocupa es que realmente solo se ocupe lo que ya viene incluido en la base de datos. que no se ocupen herramientas externas y enseñar a los DBAs a ocupar lo que ya tienen. We have another question here. It says if the seminar is going to be focused in restricting or accessing the information. It says that perhaps it's a kind of input-output of information.
I'm not sure I understand.
It says that if perhaps you're going to talk about accessing data or accessing information or just regarding data in the security seminar.
Are you going to touch
this topic?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so the data access and how to protect the data access, yes, that will be covered. Is he talking about application security, like application securing applications to make sure data access is secure or what? Yes, I will be covering that, but I'm not sure if that is the case. That's what he asked.
Okay, Nicolás, no, comenta Rup que sí, sí van a tocar estos temas de acceso y resguardo de información, entre otros, y que si te interesaría o tu pregunta si va más enfocada al tema de desarrollo de aplicaciones para hacerlas seguras hacia la base de datos. No sé si nos pudieran ahí aclarar esa parte. Ok, por ahí pregunta... Rebecca Rubio, ¿se puede asistir al evento con personas con perfil técnico? Okay, Arup, we have a question here. It says that if non-technical people can attend to this event.
Yes, absolutely. For example, the third day, it is actually going to be mostly non-technical, and for other two, they can attend and understand what the technical people can do, because as a leader, sometimes you have to do. You have to tell other people to do it, so you will get enough information to ask others to do it. Yes, it will be helpful for them.
Okay, Rebecca, nos comenta Luke que sí pueden asistir personas con un perfil que no sea técnico. Realmente aquí lo importante es que se puede sacar provecho y tú puedes, si no eres una persona técnica, entender cuáles son las características y requerimientos que puedes solicitar para posteriormente pasarlas a tu área operativa como el área de base de datos. Arup, we have another question. Aquí otra pregunta dice que qué hay acerca de la seguridad de base de datos en un cluster. It says there is something to do about security in the databases in a cluster.
Yes, absolutely. Like for example, CRS cluster, etc. Yes, I will be covering that.
Arup comenta que sí vamos a tener temas de seguridad dentro de un cluster. Perhaps advice that you can give to Ricardo Olmos about regarding in security database in a cluster, just briefly. Okay. Now I can hear you, Rup.
Okay. No, I was talking.
Is there
now.
Any advice that you can give to Ricardo Olmos about? Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. You asked.
En el evento se va a platicar de eso.
You asked me if you if I can give an
you
advice
can give
right
us
now.
A quick advice, a brief advice about security.
It can be difficult to do
now,
that.
Just briefly think. Yeah.
Can't do that right now. They just said this is what we're covering.
I know.
I think the last question is that we can transfer this scenario to another database, or this is only for Oracle. Again, I answered this. Yeah, this is only for Oracle database, not for any other, not like SQL Server or MySQL or something.
Okay, la pregunta que hizo Nicolás fue si esto que vamos a ver en los seminarios puede aplicarse a otra base de datos diferente a la de Oracle. Arup nos comenta que no, que solo es aplicable para la base de datos de Oracle. Si hay más preguntas, por favor, pónganlas ahí en el área de chat, por favor. Arup, Nicolás is asking if you're going to talk about cloud topics in our seminars.
Cloud? Oh yeah, cloud, yes, I will. That's the third day, yes. There is no presentation. I will talk about it if the question comes up. So if this question does come, yes, I will.
Okay. Sí, sí va a haber, Nicolás, temas de la nube, no enfocados en Azure, más enfocados a tema de cloud, pero de Oracle, Databases as a Service de Oracle, en el tercer día. We have another question here from Jenny Gutierrez. It says that if you're going to include the best practices when you create or data, they require some advanced security in those two tools.
Best practices for Oracle Advanced Security? Yes, I will.
Okay, Arun nos comenta que sí, sí va a tener ahí temas de seguridad avanzada para estos temas. Arun, son 2 días de seminario y el tercero es una charla presencial. En la cual, bueno, es como un roundtable en el cual van a presentar sus preguntas uno a uno con Arup y Arup las va a ir respondiendo. Ahí puedes coger cualquier tipo de tema que tenga que ver la base de datos de Oracle. Arup, we have another question here. It says that if this seminar is going to be focused just in version 12c or in which version of the database?
No, not 12c. I'll be covering 11g, 12c as well, everything, not just 12c.
Okay, se verán tanto versiones de base de datos como dos y los scripts sirven para las diferentes bases de datos. Okay, creo que alguien estaba escribiendo por ahí. No, Catalina, no se requiere ningún tipo de software. En realidad, nosotros les vamos a dar el material para que trabajen ahí. Es un material impreso. Los scripts también se los van a llevar para que no tengan que estarlos escribiendo. Entonces, no hay como ningún problema en ese sentido. Arup, we have another question here. It says that if you're going to talk about security in Apex applications.
No. Apex is a client tool. So this is Oracle database security. So no, I will not talk about Apex or any other tool for that matter.
Okay, dice Arup que no. No, no se van a tocar temas de seguridad para Apex. Apex pues al final es un cliente de la base de datos, no es entrar directamente a la base de datos.
But Ricardo can also say that.
Okay, bueno, creo que bueno, si tienen
Apex security, if you do a database security, Apex security is also taken care of automatically, right? So it's not, Apex security is not something entirely different from database security. It is a part of database security itself.
Okay. Arup comenta que Apex es, bueno, una herramienta que consulta al final cosas de la base de datos y mientras tengas la parte blindada de la base de datos, pues bueno, es más que suficiente. Bueno, pongamos 3 preguntas más, por favor, y con eso terminaríamos el día de hoy. Aaron, como te comentaba, el tercer día es un roundtable, o sea, vamos a reunir a todos los que atiendan y que vayan al evento para que tengan como preguntas one-on-one con Arup, o sea, que se puedan responder uno a uno. Y pueden ser de cualquier tema que se te ocurra, o sea, puede ser desde nube hasta rack, clusters, audit vaults, o sea, todo lo que tenga que ver pertinente a eso. Por ahí pusieron mal mi correo, es ricardo.najera.rivas. Arup, here's another question, yeah. Just 2 more questions. Yeah, it says, what is better, best practices or security, or depends on the case of the project, how we can choose it. Example, in a traditional process, we need speed. transactional process. Okay, let me translate it to Spanish. It says, dice, ¿qué es mejor o cuáles son las mejores prácticas para seguridad o depende del caso o proyecto? ¿Cómo podemos escoger entre ellas? Ejemplo, si tenemos procesos transaccionales, necesitamos velocidad. Y en otros, pues necesitamos seguridad.
Yeah, so I'm not sure that I understand the question. So what is better, best practices for security, or depends on case or project? As in anything, you have to decide the, your pros and cons of each, and then find out what applies in your situation. So let me give an example. Virtual private database, which is great for security, but for extremely performance intensive application, virtual private database is going to be bad. So you have to decide how you want to do it.
Okay, lo que Arup nos dio fue un pequeño ejemplo del tema de seguridad. O sea, hay algunos casos en los que el tema de seguridad obviamente va a ser el resguardo de información, pero en otros sí pegarle directamente a la velocidad transaccional que tenemos. Entonces sí dependería del proyecto, de lo que tú quieras sacar tal cual en tu aplicación. ¿Dos preguntas más? Dos preguntitas más y con eso terminaríamos por el día de hoy. No, al contrario a ti, Nicolás.
Ok, buenas tardes. ¿Si no hay ninguna otra pregunta? Bueno, creo que
ya no hay preguntas.
Muchísimas gracias, Ricardo. Thank you very much, Arup. Vos mandarás la presentación. Nuestros medios de Oracle les mandarán más información acerca del evento, de cómo pueden participar. Si están fuera de la Ciudad de México, cómo pueden encontrar más información. Aquí tenemos a Salvador. Salvador es parte del equipo de Oracle. Y muchas gracias a todos por asistir. Y nos estamos viendo en siguientes ediciones de otros webinars. Hasta luego y que tengan muy buena tarde. Sí, enviaron la sesión grabada a Armando. Y las compartiremos. Editamos un poco, ajustamos un poco el audio. Y en un par de días máximo mandamos la presentación. Hasta luego, que tengan muy buena tarde todos.
Ok. Thank you very much. Gracias. And I will see you on May 3rd, 4th, and 5th. Hopefully. Anything else, Ricardo? I think you have done the questions, right?
Thanks very much. Thank you. No. Thanks a lot, Arup. You give a great webinar here. So, hope to see you soon in May.
Very good. All right, me too. See you then. Thank you very much, and have a good evening.